श्रीमते रामानुजाय नमः। टुडेज टॉपिक इज मोर वाइब्रेंट, मोर डायनामिक, मोस्ट एसेंशियल एंड ऑल एनकंपैसिंग। इट इज जस्ट स्पिरिचुअलाइजिंग द नेशन, nationalizing the people. So it includes nation, people, as well as the process of nationalization and spiritualization. The words are very catchy, they are very pregnant, they are very effulgent and brilliant. So it is my duty to bring up the splendor and abysmal glory of the values and polydimensional status that is hidden in these terminologies. If you say about nation, it just means the geography, topography, epigraphy and demography of a vast space. Apart from this, there are innumerable subtle instincts, emotions, their sequential impacts and their connective and multiple effects in various layers of the society, reflecting in individual, psychological, intellectual, social, cultural and international values and movements. Apart from this, if you want to say about the nationals, there are innumerable nationals. There are scholars, there are students, there are politicians, there are orators, there are Swadeshi scientists, there are technicians, there are patriots, there are commons, and there are a lot of people in the society in various settings. And in spite of lot of people crying, craving, calling and trying to integrate the same society and the umbrella of the so-called nationalism, still we find lot of gap between the practicality and theoretical exposition. And whatever we see or we hear or we read from the books and orations, that maintain a very great cleavage and distance between what we envision in the hidden dimensions of the society in the rural, tribal and downtrodden communities. This is because of various factors, and it is our duty to go into the success stories of our past and past methodologies, and for promptitude and for magnitude and multitude in our expressions, as well as the so-called desirous benefits, it is our duty to go also into failure investigations, which is the main causative factor, driver for the failure that exists in the society, maintaining a distance between the proclamations and the experiences. Number one is time factor. The time has driven the modern society to go into an endless race, so that the dedication is either transient or ephemeral or peripheral. So this time factor is the major constraint of the society by which people, in spite of having ideologies and methodologies, could not unite. Second thing is the crisis of proper direction. Each and everybody is not properly self-organized. It is just like the solidification of ice inside the refrigerator, that inside an auditorium we are have here conglomerated, federated to have a solid mood, totally directed towards a particular ideology. But still, if we are being directed to aberrant conditions, various other personal extensions, immediately our contribution and our exercises are totally scattered into innumerable pieces, and then consolidation or fortification is totally lost. So each and everybody, they require self-direction. Even though they have proclamations, they have projects, even though they have lot of statements and commitments and sentiments, but still a solid booster by which they can stand by themselves in the state and also invigorate others to commit the same, it requires lot of self-direction principles. So even though the people, they have some emotional outbursts, they are contextual, and they are very, very ephemeral in nature. So lack of proper direction in individuals. Third thing, directed people can only be led by leaderships. If these people are not properly directed, or they cannot be directed by a leadership innovation or a motivation, then it is not going to result in any use. So there is a leadership crisis. What is the type of leadership crisis? Improper leaders are there. And leadership is a chain. No leader can take you to the abode of God. Each and every leader takes you to the consecutive step, gradually you are linked with the upgrade of essence of the society. Like in the academic status, each and every teacher leads you to the other person. Leadership also, there is some immediate leadership, there is inceptive leadership, intensive leadership, transcendental leadership, ultimate leadership, all-encompassed leadership, innumerable leaderships are there in the society. There is no leadership connectivity. So, the problem with leadership is improper leadership or unorganized leadership. There is no connectivity even if we have leaders, and quarrel between the leaders instead of integrity. Fifth thing is our own zeal or awareness to become the leaders and suppress others. These qualities are the so-called envisioned qualities or pseudo-qualities of this leadership that is valued in the society has hindered the progress. That is the leadership crisis. And the fourth thing is diversion. Each and everybody is having their own problems and they are diverted in awareness and fear. They are shuffled between these instincts. Apart from which, most of the people, they are struggling for survival and establishment. They are living in life insecurity. And those people, they cannot be committed for this type of activities. So this time, dedication, leadership, personal organization and various other essential ingredients for climbing a real productive nationalism is lacking in the society, which is the main reason for the leadership to be evergreen always in words and books, not there in the practical format. So taking this into account, these qualities are to be considered on how to develop this nationalized ideology and methodology among the society is the nucleus of today's topic. Number one, there are innumerable numbers in the society. In leadership also, there are three major groups of people. One is the struggling leaders, and second is the seasonal leaders. Those who have seen lot of things of sacrifice, those who have committed much with magnanimity, erudition, compassion, and all the other essentialities of leadership. There are seasoned leaders, maybe very few in number, infinitesimally negligible in number. There are seasonal people. And the second people, there are sleeping leaders. There are people, lot of people with sleeping qualities. The third thing is those who are having the qualities but insufficient due to organizational behavior or organizational network, those people are struggling in the society. And these people, they have to contact with five members of the society. Number one, those who are abundant in knowledge and resources. Number two, those who are sufficient in knowledge and resources. Third thing, those who are negligent in nature, those who are absent, and those who are opponents. It is told in Shastra as Samajika Panchavibhaga. So there are people who are abundant in the society, those who are sufficient, Parimita in the society, and those who are Mita in the society, insufficient or negligent in society, those who totally Abhava, those who don't have these qualities, and Vaiparitya is opponent. So we have to meet all of these people, and if you say nationalize the people or spiritualize the society is a medley of varieties of people with various spiritual, mental and emotional and environmental grounds. You cannot create a customized or you cannot create a generalized view or a tool for all of these people. How to deal with an abundant is different from an absent, and how to deal with an opponent is different from that of a person who is sufficient in resources. So this is the methodology. And one more thing is that, number one, can we bring immediate impact of this thing? Number one. Number two, can we bring complete impact of this thing? Even if you bring the impact in the complete society, that is known as Purna. Second thing is immediate, sadhya. Third thing is grade, sthiti or paristhiti. So there are three questions while asking about nationalization or spiritualization. Can we make the complete society nationalized and spiritualized? Number one. Can we make it immediately? Number two. The third thing, can we bring the same spirit of nationality or spiritualism to all people? It is not easily possible because there are a lot of people who are anticipatory in nature. They are avoiding such a leadership, such a congregation, such association and mutual share of love and knowledge. Those people can be easily managed. And second thing is there are a lot of people who are convincible. The third thing is rationalists in the society. They must be explained and they must be induced and directed. Fourth thing is the downtrodden members of the society. Everybody, they target only at the downtrodden members of the society. Those who are totally trampled under insufficiency, paucity and total insecurity, they can be handled by any person, like a doll and puppet. Politicians, theologians, converters, inverters, inhibitors of the society, they all totally concentrate on those people because they are suffering. Suffering people, for their development or immediate relief, they will be obliging any sort of relief or mechanism that you prescribe. So, these type of approaches to downtrodden members, rational members and convincible members, as well as the committed, readily available members of the society are to be practically tuned. For that we have to make 5 T's. Who is our target? Immediate target, immediate target, remote target. And what is the time frame that is required? Who is the team which is going to work on it? And what is the technique and what are the tools? So target, tool, techniques, time and the team, we have to properly describe, and taking this as an opportunity to frame the skeleton on which we have to wrap it with the flesh and blood, then with skin, then with spirit, then with soul, and make it to execute. So this is a preliminary schedule in which we are going to discover the possibilities of getting into the process of molding these 5 T's gradually, slowly, but effectively. And this is what we call the model plan for the spiritualization as well as the nationalization of the society. And what do you mean by this nationalization? I told about nationals and the various levels of impact on the society possible in future. Nationalization is of 4 types. One is internal, second is indigenous, third is integral, and fourth is international. And the so-called, the first, what we call that internal nationalism is to be very much associated with the fragments of the land, the customs, traditions, by wearing the robes, by wearing the marks, by following the essence of philosophy and way of life of our land. What is our ontology? What is our teleology? What is the axiology? And what is the structure of the human network and their functional status and destinational system in our geomechanics, in our prescribed or demarcated geomechanics of the traditional scriptural and spiritual lineage of our land. So this is known as internal, that deals with something religion, philosophy, etc. Second thing is indigenous, that deals with something more than that. That deals with our own produce, distribution, our local development, our integrity and strengths. The third thing is integral, which makes us to associate with other lands, connected lands, related lands, permeated lands, and other radiant homogeneous status to lands and people, and to create a totalitarian strong structure and powerful structure for our land is integral approach. What we are having as worldwide network for our traditions, customs, beliefs and practices. Fourth thing is international. International is entirely different. To get equivalence, to get hypervalence and excellence in science and technology, energy systems, in moral superiority, and also in supremacy, in technicality, in global renaissance, and also as a forerunner and pioneer for values like brotherhood, fraternity, tolerance, and organizing everything under one umbrella. So these things are known as international views. So we are having innumerable such views in this society. And there is always, you know, that wherever there is a solution, solution will be succeeded only by a problem, and each and everything is inbuilt with lot of problems and challenges. Likewise, we are also having a paradoxical debate or a combat in all of these systems. Even in this so-called nationalism, we used to see that. The number one thing is, it is a parallel combat of urban and rural development. Second thing is the combat between the tolerance level of modernity or the so-called fashion and developments or modification in the society, along with the values, heritage, and ethical principles of the land. This is the second parallel combat. And the third parallel combat is between eradicating the basic social evils of poverty, illiteracy, unemployment, and insecurity. And at one end, it is industrial development, science and technology development, new inventions of biomedical engineering in the form of elixirs, cloning, and other. So many other bioethical conversions. So we have lot of things being faced on either side. One is on advanced level, second is on grassroots level. Simultaneously, we have to develop trade, tourism, and international relations and fraternity. At the same time, we have to consider also about various other specialized issues like space engineering and nuclear power engineering. So innumerable things are there that is connected with human, that is connected with human advancement, that is connected with the primordial step, that is connected with the ultimate step, either scientifically or technically ultimate step. So there is a parallel combat or this dualism always going on. That's why somebody asked a question, why we are doing this Chandrayaan in spite of not promoting the welfare of the rural people, innumerable people that are in the infant mortality rate, lot of people are in malnutrition, lot of people are more illiterate in the society, and why there is an imbalance or a paradoxical governance of one high-end extremity on one side, and one side it is an inferior extremity, we which makes the normal people or the so-called basic grass members of the society to be totally trampled under insufficiency and paucity. Why it is done so? So, in order to nationalize all the students or all the vigilant members of the society, even the commons, they have to understand few basic principles. Nation, it represents two things. One, it represents the collective quantitative population of a society. Number two, specifically, it refers only to those people, those who are structurally, functionally connected and committed to the development or existence mechanism of the nation. For example, in a school's register, we cannot include lizards and cockroaches only for the reason that they are also inside the school campus. Likewise, a lot of people in the society, those who are not connected in the executive or the developmental mechanism, they are not qualitatively connected with the count or the so-called methodology of taking the census of validity of a national standard. Apart from this, the representation of various members of the society, knowingly or unknowingly, as a wonder or blunder, they must have selected somebody to rule. And that selector committee, that will represent the nation. So the third representation, that is the government, it is just designated by the term nation. And whenever a country is having political stability, there only nationalization is possible and nationalization is assurable. So political assurance, that gives social assurance, and social assurance in turn, with proper vigilant and meticulous care and election, that brings political stability. So politics is the base for everything, and somehow unfortunately, just as great people told, lot of unwanted elements, they grow only by the negligence and subservience of the so-called noble and honest members of the society. Dishonesty is nourished only by the ignorance, subservience and negligence of the innumerable committed or to be committed members of the society. So political stability is very much important, and there may be a question, what is the use of the students or anybody thinks that getting into politics is nothing but one more personification of rascaldom or something else which is unusual or dangerous to one's own ethical or social status. It is not like that. Active politics is of two types. One is getting into positions, ruling, establishing the throne, and verification of the possibilities of being rethroned and continuously being thrown. These things are one part of active politics. The second thing is to properly select a person, number one, to integrate people for proper selection, number two, to watch that the rule is proper or not, number three, to demand whatever you want, number four, and to seek for a judicial favor or justice if the things are not done, and dethrone the person in the next thing. These six things are the commitments of all people. It is also the part of active politics in which students should take rule. And it creates a healthy social mechanism and makes a salubrious political system. That is number one. Number two, we must be very much proud of our heritage. Generally, nationalism is the four things. More productivity inside the nation. Number two, local distribution and assuring happiness of the inhabitants of the land. Number two. Number three, being proud of our own culture. Number four, love and respect for all. These four qualities are the qualities of nationalism. The third quality is to be proud of our own culture. How do we explain or how do we expect that the proud or the so-called heritage pride mechanism should be? There are four things. You proclaim that your system is proud. You preach to others with the logics, rationale and applications that your system is something which is having innate and inexhaustible pride. Number three, apart from preaching, you also establish in the society by practice. That is the third point. Number four, whenever there is a blemish, irrational blemish on your pride, protest legally, non-violently, protest against it and restore the glory of the land. So, proclaiming the glory, preaching the glory, and practicing the glory so that I'm seeing that everybody should try to imitate it and try to envy on your standards. Preach and practice it and protest it non-violently when there is even the slightest possibility of any blemish on it. This is known as real nationalism. So, we have to explain to the society what is the significance of your heritage, what is the meaning of your heritage, what is the meaning of your heritage, each and everything, and what is the significance in each and everybody's life? Number three, what is the relevance of those things in contemporary life? Fourth, what is the futuristic vision? What is the aim for all of those things in bringing a global brotherhood? This is how we have to deal with heritage. The third thing is religious renaissance. Whenever a system is subjected to a disease, we must try to cure it. Or whenever it is beyond our cure, we have to amputate it, that we are doing in medical system. So we have to see that it is immediately considered and it is immediately taken care of. For example, political system, there is corruption. Education system, there is quality reduction. Professional system, there is lack of commitment. So everywhere, not only in religious systems, everywhere there is a totalitarian degradation. We see biodegradation and geo-degradation. What about the religion? It is also part of society. So whatever we are seeing as degradation is not exclusive for religion at all, but as religion is having higher and more vehement sentiments, which are very much ubiquitous in the society, that must be careful. That's why I used to say, all professions are noble in nature. They are all noble. And when you are capable of serving others, that profession naturally becomes nobler. Even if you get something professional for money transaction, that profession, if it is following the ethical standards, that is noble. If you consider the society and relax or make yourself more flexible, that becomes nobler. And safeguarding the life of people and restoring their salubrity and homeostasis, that medical profession is said to be the noblest. So somebody committing mistake is different from the medical professional person doing mistake. It is entirely different. A butcher killing a goat is entirely different from the parental or the mother goat killing its own goat. So it is the duty of protection, prevention and assurance of the essential resources for a fruitful extended life. So if there the ethical implementation is violated, that becomes a cruel and brutal, heinous, inexcusable offense. Likewise, in religion, it is a possibility for purification of everybody. If it itself is impure, then that is a heinous danger to the society. Now in religion, we are having a lot of problems. One is superstition. Second thing is religious violence. Third thing, non-contribution to the society. Religion does not contribute anything to the society. If it is contributed, the fourth problem is self-centrism. So religion is pestered by self-centric people, non-contributors to society, superstitious beliefs and practices, and violence in the society. So it must be taken care by these students. They cannot totally eradicate the religious system, or they cannot create a deen-ilahi, new system cannot be created, or all systems cannot be easily synchronized and synergized. So they have to be maintained in level standards, removing this speed. So it is known as religious renaissance that must be brought for real nationalization. And the final point is, there is accusation. Whenever you start something, somebody will accuse. Nationalization is always considered to be a very narrow approach. So somebody says, if there is mere nationalization in no broader standards, then it is against globalization or global standards or universal brotherhood or global village. It is not like that. It is concentration. See, whenever you are going to support somebody, if somebody has fallen inside the well, and anybody who is going to support and make the person to come out the well, then he will balance himself in such a sturdity so that he can pull the person. So nationalism is not against internationalism or globalization. The so-called pseudo-globalization, in which the major power blocks of the world, they only develop by exploiting the temptation and resources of few committed developing countries, it is not globalization. Real globalization is founded on the base of nationalization. Unless you are strong and well organized, you cannot deal with the international people without sacrificing our dignity and standards. So that's what we want. So this is what we call nationalization, that we have clearly explained. Now coming into the other developmental standards, how to create our own inner strength. Number one, there are two things. You have to form a team and you have to deform the already existing team. I told in one seminar on terrorism, the only strength for terrorists is they are organized. They are integrated. And the only weakness for us is we are not organized. If 10 terrorists unite together for destruction, daily they will meet and discuss till the destruction is implemented. But wherever if we speak about construction, immediately we will forget and we will be thinking about something else. And the second thing is, if two people work for construction, they will be having egoistic clashes, you or me. If somebody, two people or five people or a gang of people, if they work for some destruction, forgetting their egoism, they will concentrate only on the destruction. So this type of quality, at least we need not learn from the sages, seers and scholars of the society. We have to learn only from the terrorists, and that we have to apply on salubrious standards and execution. So this is the level of the society now. So now we have to create three things. If we are integral, then the other people will be afraid. To create fear in the minds of the people, we want to do two things. One is to be integral, and second is to create military as well as retributive judicial strength in the country so that everything will be proper. The second thing is 5-by phenomena. If you are integral, if you have proper retributive justice also, and also if you have proper military strength, then that will develop the country and that will create permanent fear on the other people. Now it has created permanent fear on the subjects of the nation, not on the other community. It has created perennial fear. Now the terrorists are in combatant soles, and the so-called people who are assured combatant soles, they are in evergreen terror. So we must have patriotism, we must have pride, we must have pity, we must have privilege, and we must have prestige. Yes, it is my duty to protect, I have to do that. And it is my inborn instinct that I have to take care of the land which gives me solace, comfort, shelter and shadow. And it is my pride that to be born on this land. And the contemporary situation is very pitiable. So anything like patriotism, the soil connection, our pity, our privilege, our prestige, or any of these things,
Swamiji, for your inspiring, enlightening, and valuable words.